Very good evening and a warm welcome to friends, fellow trust members, journalism students and media professionals to the 16th Professor Bashiruddin Memorial Lecture this evening. Every year we have been holding the event at the Administrative Staff College in a physical mode. The lecture delivered by accomplished media professionals and academicians is a homage to our dear Professor Bashiruddin, and as an expression of gratitude and contributions to mass media that he has made. 2020, however, has posed enormous and extraordinary challenges, and our lecture, which usually is held between September, October, could not be held for obvious reasons. However, as Bashiruddin showed us a lot of innovations in teaching and also his methods of answering solutions, we decided that we will go the virtual way. And to our great advantage, the Usmania Journalism Association and department came to our rescue, and they said they will host this. We were doubly happy when Professor Sridhar Acharyulu agreed to our request to deliver this lecture. To our satisfaction, and also over a period of time, Bashiruddin Memorial Lecture has been attracting very distinguished speakers. In the past few years, we had Krishna Prasad, former editor Outlook, Mohan Guruswamy, Professor Mohan Raj, S. Jaipal Reddy, Gautam Adhikari, M.J. Akbar, Sanjay Baru, Syed Akbaruddin, who incidentally is former Indian ambassador, permanent ambassador to the United Nations, Paranjay Guha Thakurta, and many, many others. To those new to the lecture, the trust has been started by a group of students of Bashiruddin. And as Matthew Joseph often says, we were all students of Bashiruddin or SOBs. And Matthew has been the driving force behind the Bashiruddin Memorial Trust over a long period. And to those unfamiliar with Professor Bashiruddin, I would like to tell you that for many, many years, Bashiruddin was synonymous with the Usmania Journalism Department. Very interestingly, he started as a student, he became a lecturer, and finally headed the Department of Journalism and took it to heights. He was a very well-known personality in mass media in the country, and also one of the first public relations experts in the country. No wonder that in a career, he scaled new heights. He became the first vice chancellor of the B.R. Ambedkar Open University, and also was India's ambassador to Qatar for a few years. In this background, today's speaker, Professor Sridhar Acharyulu, I would like to introduce. Although for most of the journalist fraternity, he is quite familiar. To me personally, Professor Sridhar Acharyulu is known for the last three and a half decades. He is a multifaceted personality. He is a journalist, a lawyer, and an academician. And unlike most of us journalists who are good in either writing, or some of us are a bit okay in talking, Sridhar Acharyulu is both an expert on writing on many subjects as well as speaking. So we look forward to a wonderful session this evening. He is also presently with the Bennett University, Law University in Delhi, teaching law. To give a little bit of background for Professor Sridhar Acharyulu, journalism has come naturally. It's in his genes, I think. He was virtually groomed by his father, who a freedom fighter and also the editor of Warangal Vani. So Sridhar Acharyulu grew up in the newsroom, as I would like to inform this audience. From there, he did his law in Kakatiya University. And then he came to Usmania University, and I would be very glad to inform all of you that he's a gold medalist from Usmania University. journalism again brought him to Udayam newspaper in the 80s, and he made a mark immediately with I would like to give an example. He wrote extensive series of articles on the TTD's functioning during that time when Mr. N.T. Ramarao was the chief minister. Those articles made an impact. And 35 years later, in 2020, when Y.S. Jagan government also wanted to do certain things, Professor Sridhar Acharya's views on TTD and government interference were considered very seriously. For Sridhar Acharya also, journalism was, I think, the beginning. Then he migrated to law and joined the Nalsar University of Law when it was started in Hyderabad. And at the Nalsar University, he did a lot of work on copywriting, on plagiarism, and also he brought the image to the fore by writing several books on law, which are now, some of them are referral to students also. Now, he made a mark at the national level in the last 10 years or so, when he was made the Central Information Commissioner, one of the team. And at the CIC, I think he was instrumental in bringing out several important issues to the public domain. And I would like to give you one example of how his persistence brought the important documents on the case of our former Prime Minister Lal Bahadur Shastri's sudden death in Tashkent in the 1960s. And his constant badgering the government through the Right to Information Act brought all these documents into public domain. Sridhar Acharyalu has been a champion of RTI, and I would like to tell all our young friends and colleagues that his forthright views on RTI and freedom of expression did not endear himself to the Modi government, and he was at loggerheads. But what he has done during those 5 years as CIC, I am sure will be very useful in future. And his contribution to freedom of expression through writing has immense contribution, and I am sure the freedom of expression will be upheld, and we will have a good body of knowledge and information through RTI that will come out in future. The last thing I would like to tell this audience is Professor Sridhar Acharyalu has been very contemporary in his approach. We started with print like most of us, but he has been quick to migrate to the visual medium through portals and YouTube, and today you can find him writing a couple of articles some days, doing a YouTube program, and also doing a public speech. So I am delighted on behalf of the Basharuddin Memorial Trust, the organizing committee members, the PR club, the PR association, the Administrative Staff College of India, the Usmania Journalism Department, and all of us to welcome and hand over the stage to Dr. Sridhar Acharya to talk on a subject which again he chose and is very, very tempting and tantalizing. The subject is irregular media and impossible regulation. I think all those practicing journalists know that it's a nice subject. Over to Dr. Sridhar Acharya.
Thank you so much, Somshekhar Garu. So kind of you, so nice of you. You have reviewed my activities very, very with kind words and great words. Thank you so much for that.
Thank you.
I'd like to say, of course, let me first address the head of the department, Professor Stevenson, and so many elder personalities of the profession, seniors of the profession of journalism, senior teachers in Journalism College of Usmania University, and my friends, colleagues, so on and so forth. It's my great pleasure to be here as an invitee. I'm a student of BCJ. I'm a student of MCJ of this journalism school. And I'm so happy that as a student of this university and this college, I am now standing here as a person giving Bashiruddin Memorial Lecture. Bashiruddin, I know I heard him many a time. And when I was a student in MCJ, he gave a couple of lectures and I was very keenly listening to it. He's really a wonderful person and a wonderful teacher. The way he communicates is very, very impressive. It's great that I could listen to him at least a couple of times, though I am not a direct student of Professor Bashiruddin. And most of the teachers now working in the journalism school here are my teachers. So I thank all those teachers for giving me the education. And I'm MCJ. I did my MCJ in 1996. After becoming lecturer, law lecturer, I did my journalism. And I'm happy that I have all the 4 gold medals from the journalism school. So I think it's a great privilege to me. And it's a great sanman for me to talk on this topic. In Nalsar University of Law, I have started a course called Media Law, PG Diploma in Media Law. And even for regular students, I used to offer a seminar paper on Media Law.
Madhavu Sridhar.
Yes, Madhavu Sridhar. Yeah, I used to teach and I used to teach the diploma students also, PG Diploma in Media Law. It was started in 2004. And when I started it, there were only 4 students from all over the country, which was considered as a failure course because nobody is bothered about media law. And I was feeling guilty whether I have done any mistake. Did I think of in advance to have a course of media law and teach journalists and journalism students? That was my repenting time. Then my vice chancellor, Professor Ranbir Singh, said, "It is not viable, Professor. What do you want me to do?" Then I said one thing. Today it is only having 4 students, but we cannot say that same thing will continue tomorrow also. This is one point. Number 2, the course which you are thinking are considering as very successful may not be successful tomorrow. Then what kind of response will be there from the university to that course also? Then number 3, what I said is, we are not a company. We are not a commercial organization. We are a university. A course which is successful should subsidize a course which is essential. Then as a university, state-funded university, university of excellence, I think Nalsar University should not get a name that it has started a course and because the students have not come, it has closed. It's a prestige issue. And then he was convinced with my argument and he continued the course. And today it's one of the most successful courses. Today I have around 150 students. It is 15th or 16th year running. And we are doing very successfully. And one of the students told me, I'm happy that somebody said he's my student. Thank you so much. Okay. Then one of the students told me that, sir, do you know how many universities are offering this course, PG Diploma in Media Law? I don't know. I said, I don't know. I am offering. Maybe some universities are also offering. Do you know what he said? Sir, only 2 universities. 2 universities in India, only 2. No, sir, 2 universities in the world. Then I'm surprised. I didn't know that it is only, I thought I'm one of the many. Then he said it is Oxford University.
Ravane.
Oxford University, which is offering the PG Diploma in Media Law. And next is Nalsar University of Law. So I feel I'm privileged that I got that opportunity of starting a unique course. And still today, I'm running it. I'm teaching it. I'm requesting some of our colleagues sometimes to join that course and address them on journalism aspects of media law. Okay, why I'm talking about this media law? Because today's topic is about regulation. Regulation that should happen through law. I've been talking about law since 2004 to my students in my university. But even in journalism schools, I was talking about regulation of media law in Enadu Journalism School and various other journalism schools I was continuously teaching. Usmania University also, I taught media law several times. And now, when I went to Delhi as information commissioner, it was difficult for me, so I was not doing it. So that is my association with media law. And there is my book is named Law of Expression. It's a big volume. Aishia Law House has published that book. This is a compendium of various legislations and a commentary, critical commentary on media law that will operate as a regulatory. Some disturbance is coming. I request you to mute when you are not about to speak. You please mute your speakers so that I can teach. I'm hearing all your private talk. You are breaching your own privacy, and I'm not supposed to hear all that. And every other person also should not hear. Please protect your privacy. And that is one of the subject matters I'm going to talk about today. Okay, coming to the point, the topic of the day which I chose is irregular media and impossible regulation. When I say irregular media, I am not here to admonish or judge. The entire profession is as irregular, but I am only talking about its organizational setup and its organizational functional attitudes that are coming up, coming into the fore nowadays. I am intending to talk about that. But before I go on to criticize the aspect of media as an estate, one of the most important estates of four estates that we talk about, the Constitution doesn't talk about fourth estate. It talks only about three estates: judiciary, executive, and legislature. But we have given the great importance and similar importance, and we treat media on par with the three estates, constitutional estates, and we consider media is exercising such an influential power, which one of the constitutional estates could have done. So that is the importance of the fourth estate. Now, we have developed a kind of society that we are seeing now, wherein the credibility of three estates is terribly low. I'm sorry to say, we have to criticize all the three estates for this kind of situation. I just give you one example, how the executive power has been exercised by the political executive of present day. During the pandemic days, they have brought three ordinances to deal with farm marketing, farm produce, and farm produce price, farm produce contracts. And then the parliament has been convened and the bills were introduced to replace the ordinances. And two houses went into pandemonium. So from pandemic, we have traveled to pandemonium. And during pandemonium, the bills were passed. And the Rajya Sabha deputy speaker, deputy chairman did not even concede to the demand of division of votes. And nobody knows how many wanted to support and how many did not want. So that was the situation. It shows failure of two estates, executive and legislature. Now, you know what Supreme Court has done with reference to farmers' agitation. First, it said humanity is more important. They have a constitutional right to protest. Farmers have a right to protest. Then it is the duty of the judiciary to step in. And one day it also gave an admonition, comment, observation, that if you don't stay, we will stay. And it has really stayed the operation of three enactments. But let me tell you, these three enactments have already had their impact. Several marketing committees have become dysfunctional, and the farmers are forced to sell to the traders at the price dictated by traders, but not a price regulated by Agricultural Market Committee. And I do not know what law is stayed today because of this order. That is a very, very pathetic situation. And the committee, which is supposed to examine impartially the issues, was filled with some members who have already taken a stand to support the farm laws. So these are the latest examples of functioning of three estates. Okay, now let us come to the fourth estate, media, our own organization. I am from media. I totally agree with Mr. Somshekhar, who talked about my father, my genes of journalism, And I did my journalism until 1993-94. I was a journalist. Then in 1994, I switched over to law teaching. Law teaching took me to Nalsar University of Law, and Nalsar took me to Central Information Commission. And from Central Information Commission, I shifted to, after Tarmi is over, I went to Times of India University, Times of India Group University, Bennett University. There I am again teaching constitutional law. So as a teacher of constitutional law, I look at the functioning of all the four estates. As a journalist also, I look at the functioning of the fourth estate. And as a designer of course of media law in Nalsar University of Law, I know how regulation is relevant and irrelevant, necessary, important, but practically impossible. How ethics, one of the papers of my PG diploma in media law is ethics. Now, I do not know whether ethics is relevant today to talk about. Very, very difficult situations, complex situations are coming up. And because it is in private domain, we cannot call it corrupt from the angle of Prevention of Corruption Act, but everybody knows that there is a huge corruption in journalism, huge corruption in media organizations. Very, very unfortunate. So before we criticize the corruption of executive legislature, and sometimes we also dare enough to face even contempt proceedings to say that some of the courts are corrupt. So we are saying it, and we are conducting surveys, and we are reporting. I remember in Delhi, one organization headed by our Telugu man, Bhaskar Rao, CMS, they have conducted a survey, and they gave a report of survey which talks about corruption, perceived corruption, practice of corruption, and the involvement of bribery in getting things done in the courts of law. They gave it as an opinion, survey of opinion of the stakeholders. That means the seekers of justice, lawyers, the court employees, and so on and so forth. That report was considered as one of the subject matters of contempt court. Extremely sorry to know that. That was also, luckily he was not convicted. This did not go up to the prosecution of the organization which conducted the survey. That's a good development. But otherwise, you see, today if anybody criticizes the judiciary, the Damocles sword of prosecution for contempt of court will be hanging. You know the Prashant Bhushan's episode and the way media reported it, the way the social media was used to put the judiciary in constant public view. Media was reporting judiciary from the beginning, but the way media is reflecting judicial functioning today never happened before. Do you know, when privacy judgment was going on, privacy hearing was going on in Supreme Court, there are at least dozen groups represented by their lawyers and correspondents who sat in the courtroom. They were giving reports minute by minute, minutes of meeting, as if they are giving minutes of meeting. They were covering every minute of the proceedings, every minute of the proceedings. And you have huge notes available about the arguments rendered by, oral arguments rendered by various lawyers representing various parts, including the questions raised by the judges and the answers given by the counsel. Very interesting. Nowhere, for no judgment, such material is made available anywhere in the world. This is a new phenomena, absolutely new phenomena. I did research on RTI and privacy. This was my LLD topic, post-doctoral research. I did it when I was in Information Commission, because I was rattled with the problem of defense of privacy whenever a member of public was asking for information from government authority. They say privacy, we will not give. So what exactly the privacy is? So I joined commission in 2013, and in 2016, the judgment came. Judgment upholding the privacy as fundamental right. I'm not disputing it. Yes, privacy is a fundamental right. Then the arguments were reported on Twitter, reported by social media groups like WhatsApp group or something like that. Student groups and the websites like Live Law and Bar and Bench, they gave verbatim report of the arguments, and it was very useful for me to understand the levels of argument and conclude about the conclusions of the judges. So that is the availability of the information today. In spite of the problems in securing and delivering information, we have greatest advantages with the technology, with the flow of information and super highway of information, that is HTTP. So you have fantastic information available. It is up to you to research. So that is the situation. Now, when so much of information is available, what media is doing is a question. What is the role of media? How is it is functioning? What is the management character? And how the staff, the lawyer staff, that means staff on the field, like reporters, sub-editors, how they are finding it difficult to report, and how the management is deciding, how is that they decide? What is the criteria of to decide whether to publish or not to publish a particular piece of information? It depends on the character of ownership. Ownership is in whose hands? And once you allow FDI, foreign direct investments, earlier FDI was not allowed, Jawaharlal Nehru times. He said no foreign newspaper should exist in this country. So every newspaper has to sell its publication to Indian owners and leave the country after independence. That's how Times of India, which was published by Bennett and Coleman Company, became the company of Jains here in India. And that company has started Bennett University, you know, and they used Bennett name, Bennett University. Coleman, they did not use Coleman, but they used Bennett name. So FDI, when government of India decided to allow foreign direct investment into various organizations, including the media, nobody knows what exactly the ownership character of Indian media. So many rumors, so many fake informations, so many WhatsApp communications, which say that this fellow owns shares in so-and-so newspaper. Nobody can exactly say which newspaper is owned by whom and which foreign company is funding and how much of funding is coming from the foreign companies. Nobody knows. Everywhere foreign direct investment is increasing. And do you know, recently there is one very interesting executive order has come reducing the FDI in media, which covers news content and critical news content, is reduced from I think 49% to 23% or 27%. They reduced. I don't know exactly how much was reduced. I don't remember now. And because of this, what happened? One website, web portal called Huffington Post has stopped its activities and totally that organization was closed. I know the investigative reporting that was going on in Huffington Post. It was mostly adverse to the present disposition of rulers. It was mostly adverse to that. It was digging, exposing, it was using RTI. The reporters of Huffington Post were regularly using RTI to extract information, official information, authentic information, and exposing the government. Do you know how media can take the help of RTI to authenticate their reports? Very, very interesting. Fantastic tool available. When I was in journalism, it was not available to me. Mr. Somshekhar was referring to TTD writings of my journalistic days. Do you know, we depended totally on internal employees to leak certain file related information. When N.T. Ramarao appointed a commission of inquiry, I was also one of the members before, as one of the parties before the commission to establish what I have written. Then I asked for inspection of files, 1985. I'm talking about 1985. Inspection of files was granted. There was a stiff resistance from the executive officer. It is my file. Who is he to ask? Then I said, it is not your file. It is my file. Then he was shocked. How is that it becomes your file? I said, I'm a donor to TTD. I gave 10 rupees, 1 rupee, half a rupee. At the time, coins of 25 NP also was there. Whenever I came, I gave something in Hundi. I may not be a rich person, but I gave something. And with that money, you are running trust. You are a trust board. And you are running that files for me. For me, I'm a donor. It's my file. And you are only a manager. You please understand your capacity. You may be an IAS officer, but you are a manager. Your duty is manager. That's all. Then court luckily accepted my argument. I'm surprised. I never expected that court will act, not court, commission will accept my argument. Accepted. Then they gave an inspection. I had inspection of thousands of files. And I picked up 389 documents. And then I listed them and I asked for an authentic copy. By the time there was no perfect photostat facility. Then I asked for, photostat facility came, though not perfect. Then I asked photostat copies. They gave with authentication certification. So I got certified copies of 389 documents of TTD files from horse's mouth, authoritatively. It happened in 1985 when there was no Right to Information Act. In 2005, do you know what Right to Information Act has given? Right of inspection of public files and right to have certified copies of selected documents of those files. And I'm happy to tell you that I have implemented Right to Information 20 years before Right to Information Act has come. Because in principle, it is our information, but there was no mechanism available for sharing it. And we have now a mechanism. Now look at the Hindu report yesterday. The Hindu reported that to a question under RTI, the government of India said there was no consultation before farmers enactments were passed. There was no consultation. You see ordinance, you see objective statement of the ordinance, you will find because it is urgent, we are passing ordinance. We are promulgating ordinance. When you say it is urgent and promulgating ordinance, where is that you have consulted? Nobody, nowhere it was consulted. Then they file an affidavit before Supreme Court saying that the consultation, it is wrong to say that there was no consultation. We have been conducting consultations for the last 20 years. Now look at this. The Hindu exposed the lie using RTI. What I am trying to tell you is the systems have come in place to help discovery of authentic information from the control of the government. We have systems. We are using, we are not using, we are abusing. There are three levels. Using, I gave you an example. Abusing, I don't want to give. Not using, whoever did not file a single RTI application being a journalist is not using it. That's all. So mechanism is there, law is there, system is there, capacity is there, and speedy communication is possible. You can file an online RTI application, you get an online certified copy of the information, but we don't do. This is the level of the utility of the technology. And today, let me tell you, if media is vibrant, if media is having a fantastic speedy reach to the people, it is because of technology. It is not because of a profession. It is not because of government. It is not because of enactments. It is because of the supreme, superior, excellent, efficient, speedy technology, information technology that we are I'm in a position, even if my article is not published by any newspaper, no problem. I can I can make you hear my voice. Fantastic. So who is helping, who is facilitating freedom of speech and expression? It is technology. So that is the media. So by giving these examples, I have already established the functioning of three estates, constitutional estates, and functioning of media also. I'm going to discuss about it. Let me refer to Press Club of India, PCI, and Indian Women's Press Corps of Delhi. Both of these organizations gave a very, very interesting statement. Very, very important statement, highly significant statement, report on February 25, 2020 about Delhi riots. An excellent report, which talks about the valiant efforts, heroic efforts of certain journalists in bringing out the truth of Delhi riots, how they suffered, how they confronted the authorities, how they confronted the mob, which are behaving like a mad group of people, which are unleashing the violence in Delhi, they reported. It's a very good report. I wish you see that. I don't want to give details because I know I can't have that much of time to explain all that. So one of the points that PCI and IWPC gave in a joint statement is, shockingly, the mobs were checking religious credentials of journalists. So journalists took such a great risk in covering that incident. And you know, in spite of organizations of media expressing their bias in reporting the events like, or disastrous events like Delhi riots in 2020, there were professionally committed journalists who were giving truthful reports, daring enough to face the mafias and the silent police, facilitating police, and active mobs driven by mafia type of activities, driven by mafia type of directions, and doing that kind of activities. So there I have to start with the greater appreciation to the media personalities who struggled to report truth of such an incident, which was a blot on the peaceful society of the social living and public order of capital city of India, New Delhi. Unfortunate. Now look at the way the organizations were reporting, and if you consider the rank that we had in 2010, which was given by the organizations called Reporters Without Borders, do you know what was our rank in 2010? It was 122. Not that it was great, somewhere in the, not even in the middle. There are 280 countries, and you stand on this side of absence of freedom, that is 122. And look at 2020. Where do we stand in 2020? 142. We have progressed towards absence of freedom of speech and expression. That is the level. Now, I'm not saying that is it because of a particular organization to be blamed or a particular media organization. I'm generally presenting the situation as reported by Reporters Without Borders. There were 6 murders in 2019. Fortunately, no killing is reported in 2020, but I don't know whether there was killing or not. There is no report. Okay, somewhat better in security related aspects, but look at the other aspects. There is huge pressure on press, and there is violation of freedom. Police violence against journalists, the ambushes by political activists, reprisals instigated by criminal groups and corrupt local officials. And then more than all that, you have unleashed with technological power the fake news, post-truth fake news phenomena is terrible. At one point of time, we were all worried about paid news. Paid news is a very, very unethical phenomena that began during the elections. we were all worried. And even today, paid news is rampant in every, almost every newspaper. It is rampant. Only a few professional organizations do not encourage the paid news, but everybody is making money, right, left, and center. Everybody, bribery, they are collecting money. That's what I'm saying. If a journalist takes money for reporting so-and-so or not reporting so-and-so, can we call it corruption? Is it a crime? Can we prosecute him under bribery? Answer is no. Because private corruption is not defined as a crime in this country till today. When you have privatized and globalized the entire activity, is it not the responsibility of the regulatory to have private corruption law also? This is recommended by Administrative Reforms Commission. I'm not sure whether it can be perfectly implemented and bribery can be controlled in journalism or any other private organization. I'm not saying that. But should you not have a system? Do you know what happened? When I was commissioner, there was one petition before me. He says, sir, I exposed the corruption of an executive engineer in PWD department in laying a road in a so-and-so area of Delhi. And when I asked for inspection of the report, they could not deny it. They gave inspection. And when I inspected the files, I could discover the corruption. I collected the authentic documents. I wanted to collect authentic documents. And then that was denied by the information officer, public information officer. And the concerned engineer offered me 10,000 rupees not to raise this issue and not to take up this in second appeal before the information commissioner. He brought a CD, recorded conversation on mobile phone between him and executive engineer. And he made him to refer to the files, refer to 10,000 rupees. And it is a perfect proof that I have nothing else to investigate but to rely on the CD. Then he says, sir, please prosecute the engineer under bribery because he has attempted to bribe me. It's bribery. Please order prosecution and order information to be disclosed. You are an information commissioner. Please do this. That was his prayer. But as information commissioner, my hands are tied and I have a limited power. I can ask for a disclosure of information. I can impose fine for not giving information. I can summon, record, and get it delivered to the petitioner. But I can't do anything more than that. Then he said, sir, what are you saying? You are a law professor. Is that fellow bribing me or not? Yeah, going by your CD, yeah, he's bribing you. Then why don't you ask the government to prosecute him? Do you know what is the position? You'll be surprised to know. There is no law. There is no definition of crime of private corruption. I can't punish public servant for giving bribe. I can punish him for taking bribe. That is the position. So we don't even have systems. Similarly, corruption in journalism, nothing can be done. It's only an ethical aspect and not a corruption. Tell me, can I regulate? That is the impossibility of regulation when I mentioned in my caption of this presentation. Irregularities. You are irregular. You are taking money for reporting and not reporting. And I cannot prosecute. I cannot regulate. There is no law to regulate. This is the position. Now, coming to, because we have already discussed fake news, let me tell you. Yeah. If I give a wrong information as correct information, am I committing any crime? That is another question. Nowhere it is defined as a crime. Again, it's an unethical aspect, like a paid news phenomena. It's not a crime. Unless I show it is excessive expenditure on the part of the political party and candidate who is contesting, I cannot call it a crime. If some journalist takes money and puts an advertisement to vote a particular party in the form of a news item, what can I do? What is the law that stops you from doing it? There is no law. There cannot be any law for that. Because it is difficult to catch. So, okay, leave it aside. Then I would like to refer to one more report of World Economic Forum. In 2017, they gave. Do you know what is their conclusion? Indian media is most corrupt with no ethics and responsibility. Edelman commission report. It is Edelman is an agency who check or who observe the credibility and the honesty levels of the media. They studied it, and their conclusion is we are number two in the world. Indian media is second most untrusted institution. So credibility criteria, honesty criteria was taken, and they judged India as number two corrupt in among the corrupt nations within the media. So this is the problem. We are irregular media. Now, what is the position in 70th year of Republic? We are in the 70th, last few days left to complete 70 years. 26 January 2020 marks completion of 70 years of Republic governance, where you have 19(1)(a), a fantastic fundamental right guaranteed by the Constitution, freedom of speech and expression. And what is it we are facing, and what is the phenomena, criteria, crisis that we are facing nowadays? Fake news with a political purpose, not just a general fake news. We are writing new history that may spell death to critical journalism. We are manufacturing the opinion, and absolutely there is no accountability. You are not answerable to anybody. And there is a vertical division of media on political lines. Objective truth is an invisible product. There is nothing that called objective truth, and we will never see it. But there is a lot of malice in reporting, in writing, in generating the news. And there is a deliberate promotion of disunity on religious lines, even in the media. And then invasion of porn on internet. Now there is for the last 2 or 3 years, I'm hearing a new phenomena. Deep fake pornography. Have you ever heard of deep fake pornography? This is done by artificial intelligence technology. Algorithms is used to transform a celebrity's photograph, a few celebrities' photographs of different angles and different moods. They are fed into computer and programmed by artificial intelligence program to create a porn video. There is no original porn. It is not making of a porn video. It is not releasing porn video. There is no porn. In fact, there is no obscene activity at all. But you create a porn using the celebrity women, celebrity men, mostly celebrity women. You create and circulate it, very difficult. And all of a sudden, one celebrity will find that there is a video in which she is exposed as porn star. What to do, where to do, where to go? And what is the complaint, and against whom you make the complaint? Social media's atrocity, an atrocious abuse of technology in social media. We are only talking about media, but how can you exclude social media when you talk about media? And when social media is correcting, exposing, destroying, distorting the original traditional mainstream media, can you ignore social media? When the print media is every day reflected in web media, and web media again goes into social media, and you share stories on social media, Facebook, WhatsApp, Telegram, and whatnot. Now, how can you say social media is different from media? We cannot say. So media inevitably includes social media, because media, the traditional media, is mainstream media is using social media. When everyone has access to a smartphone, not everyone, the most of the people, millions of people, crores of people have access to smartphones, we were all very happy. Wonderful thing happened. Technology has progressed extremely wonderful. But immediately we are flooded with fake news, deliberate fake news. How do you regulate the fake news? Can you give order of deletion? Before deletion order is given, how can anybody be assured that nobody has taken this, downloaded this program? How can you do that? Is it possible to regulate the fake media, fake news media, fake news social media, fake news generated by political parties through social media? Can we do it? Can you regulate? And by the time you understand it is fake news, the people are influenced. They have already exercised their vote in favor of a political party towards whom the fake news directed him. And the party will be in power next day. Fake news through social media, unchecked by mainstream media. Mainstream media doesn't have capacity to check the untruthful stories and fake news of social media. The result is disaster. Disaster to democracy, havoc to the social life. You tell me how much of fake news must have been used, adopted as strategy to perpetuate further riots during the Delhi riots time in Delhi 2020, February, January, February time. How much it must have happened? So that is the impact of the media, irregular social media. Then we are admirers of rulers. We have a strong haters and lovers, loving group and hating group, love group, hate group. The anchors are new judges. They judge the judges also, Supreme Court judge. No, this judge is. No, that fellow is. No, your party is. Come on, answer. Shouting journalism, shouting anchoring. Now you are new anchors. Anchors are new judges. And if you go and stand there to give a point, you know, you will not be allowed. You will be humiliated. Because if you say that X act of Y party is wrong, they will attribute that you belong to A party which opposes Y party. If I say Y is correct, then I'll be categorized as a lover or a hater. So people are divided. Social media groups are, or social media netizens have divided. This is the situation. Now, propaganda machines, we have acquired the name of propaganda machines. And I'll give you one most disastrous effect that the fake news has on an institution, Jawaharlal Nehru University. Such a wonderful institute. We are all proud to have such an institute amidst us. It gave us great leaders. It gave us great thinkers. It gave us great teachers, professors. It is giving. And we project it as the anti-national hub. Activities, hotbed of anti-national activities. We sold this untruthful fake information with proofs, with the generated proofs as a reality. And social media does it. Very, very few people came out and say that it is fake news. And today I think every media has a moral and social responsibility. I say the legal responsibility also. Because you are claiming the privileges of media. You are a really privileged community in this country, in this society, where the constitution is governing you. I think it is the moral, social, and legal responsibility of every media to have a wing to check fake news and continuously give correct reports and check reports. You must be a media watch, social media watch. Let there be several organizations coming up in this civil society to question the fake news before the fake news has attacked and destroyed the institutions. We should be very quick, so fast to say that it is fake news, don't believe it. It is fake news, don't believe it. Do you know there is one interesting WhatsApp communication. Indian national anthem has won world's best national anthem prize. And I think it's a fantastic cultural fake news. How can there be a better national anthem for a country other than their own national anthem? It is difficult to imagine to have a very number one ranked national anthem in the world. It is difficult to imagine. It is impossible. And there is no organization to judge the qualities of national anthem and declare one is somebody, some national anthem is number one and some other is number two. It is not a freedom of expression index, media freedom index, so that you can give ranks. And we are very happy. We have forwarded it. We shared it. We loved it. But nobody applies mind to know whether this is a logically possible competition wherein you give one status, one rank to a particular national anthem. In fact, there is a criticism against Indian national anthem. They say you are describing I don't subscribe to it, but I'm just mentioning that there is a controversy. Of course, I don't want to discuss that. There is a controversy about it. But how can you say that it is number one, number two? So media's destruction, the destruction caused by media, the example of JNU stands as an example. I think it's a very sad example. Okay, then there is one agency in the world, the new agency that has come up, which is called Fairness and Accuracy in Reporting, FAIR. Fairness and Accuracy in Reporting. I think we should also have such organizations in our country, and which is based in New York. And it says, the National Progressive Media Watchdog Group, they say they have formed a National Progressive Media Watchdog Group, and that challenges corporate media's biases, spins, and misinformation. And they also gave reports. Then World Economic Forum gave a report. I just talked about it. And one of the main findings of this Edelman report in 2017 is, the emergence of social media was the main reason the hypocrisy of the media got exposed. It got exposed that the people who call themselves journalists had turned into working for money and were driven by vested interests. One of the findings of this Edelman report. They cannot trust the media content anymore, as most of them have found it to be driven by vested interests and aimed to exploit the situation for gaining TRPs. A total of 28 countries were surveyed, out of which 17 countries expressed their mistrust on the media. And Indian media was seen as the second most corrupt. Indian media has been building a narrative against the country by showing anti-national characters in a positive light and anti-national thought currents as the best way to think. The media would create fake issues and start jumping over these fake stories, attempting to create an uproar in the society. This is the finding. And they may attribute motives to this organization. Say, you don't have patriotism, you are a foreigner, you don't have any this thing or that thing. Now, recently, on January 13, a Capitol attack that happened in the US was also subject matter of this FAIR reporting. And they said, they reported on January 13, 2021, what happened at the Capitol could not happen unless police allowed it to happen. This is the discovery. There has to be exposure and accountability for every single officer, for every single command official, for everyone who was involved in allowing, facilitating this white supremacist mob violence. This was the report on Capitol attack that is available in the FAIR today. Now, Trump is facing second impeachment. He's facing the consequence. Maybe it's a deterioration in the standards of democracy in the United States, one of the best countries of democracy. But there is a positive element also. Immediately they are trying to impeach him, though he is going to vacate the office very soon. They are trying to impeach him once again. And we never do it in our country. There are so many people, so many falsities are done, so many provocations are made. And one of the allegations against Trump is provoking the riot. That's enough, no? Now, where are we? Now, what is the role of the media in this kind of activity? And that is the reason why there is a huge disrespect and distrust. Now, what can we do about this misinformation? What can mainstream media do? Can they ban the fake news? Can they correct the reporting? Can they stop the incorrect reporting? what can it do? These are the very, very serious questions. And because of this misinformation, what is happening? People are divided. It is creating alienation. It is creating ignorance. And there is a misinformed extremism. And the people are crazy and they're coming out and beating the people. They're resulting, the fake report misinformation is resulting in violent activities and society is being disturbed totally. There are either false reports or partially correct reports or misreports. This is the problem in our... Then we talk about the bias. Yes, bias definitely is a source of misinformation. When I'm biased and I'll campaign, and when I campaign, I'll use all the strategies, and strategies include circulation of fake news, generating and circulating fake news. Then even in print media, a kind of a new trend of attacking the institutions has come, new trend. One such trend is, this is a very, very sorry state. When Chief Justice of India, former Chief Justice of India was nominated to Rajya Sabha, I disagree, I am not for that. Ranjan Gogoi should not have taken or should not have been offered. By offering Ranjan Gogoi, former Chief Justice of India, a nominated position of Rajya Sabha seat, the executive of the country has committed contempt of court. It brought down the image of the judiciary, dignity of the judiciary, prestige of judiciary, brought down. And by accepting, Ranjan Gogoi also has done it. This is the major damage that happened to this institution, wonderful institution, because of which we are surviving today. Without judiciary, there is no freedom of speech and expression and right to life. It is written in the Constitution, but it was made into a living reality by the Supreme Court. And because of several media persons going to Supreme Court, they created a media law jurisprudence in which freedom of speech and expression was upheld many a time. Do you know what was reported when former Chief Justice of India was nominated for Rajya Sabha? Kovind, not COVID, did it. Kovind, not COVID, did it. It is the banner headline of a newspaper. On the front page, the first news. I don't know how can anybody justify this kind of headline. Is it biased news, fake news, satire, critical attack? What is it? On whose name you are punning? You want that world pandemic COVID to be compared to highest seat holder of India? There is some similarity of sounds, phonetic similarity. Because of phonetic similarity, you will have a pun on it and then you insult the institution. You have insulted three institutions, President of India, Parliament, and Judiciary. Not Parliament, President of India, Executive, and Judiciary. Then Parliament also, because that man is selected, is made member of Rajya Sabha. You are attacking Parliament also. And you are questioning the executive because they nominated. And you are calling president with the similar name of a disease, a virus. And what kind of a headline it is? Now, are you offering any constructive criticism against this kind of nomination, which I also oppose? No. So these are the issues which bring down the trust that we had for the media and the respect that we had for the media. The vote banks still exist. What kind of vote banks? Communal vote banks. And we promote it. We have casteism vote banks. We promote it because we belong to a political party or the newspaper is owned by a political party. So these are all the various issues I thought I should present. But who can stop it? Now let us come to the regulation. It is a irregular media. Then let us come briefly talk about regulation. What kind of a regulation? Do you know there are at least 40 to 50 legislations which deal with media? 40 to 50 legislations. Do you know that there is Working Journalists Act, which was a result of agitation of Indian Working Journalists Unions? And do you know that it is suspended now? Do you know that it is suspended? There are 250 labor legislations suspended by Yogi Adityanath and followed by four or five other states. in four of those states, Working Journalists Act is also one of those legislations which are suspended. Have you ever imagined a law being suspended? A law which offers certain facilities, rights, living wages, like Working Journalists Act, suspended? So which are beneficial to you are suspended, and which are harmful to you are not suspended. They continue. What is that? These legislations, sedition, defamation, criminal defamation. And one web portal is facing a civil defamation. Don't think that civil defamation means, okay, better than criminal defamation. Don't think like that. Civil defamation here, do you know for what is the amount of damages they are claiming? Do you know what is the amount of damages they are claiming? 24,000 crores against a web portal. I don't want to give you names. Because there is an order of the court not to refer to this facts of this case and discuss in the media. Another great freedom of speech and expression example. There is a defamation case which is sensational on a media organization, and it is put up before the trial. Generally, the court are supposed to function openly. And court proceedings, you have a right to report according to Contempt of Court Act 1971. There is a specific right in Section 6, Section 5. It says journalist has a right to report court proceedings, and reporting court proceedings is not contempt of court. This is the statement. But court says don't report, don't talk about it. So I'm not giving you the names. But 24,000 crore damages sought from a news web portal. How can anybody pay 24,000 crores? I think even the topmost media organization of the country, owned by the biggest capitalist, cannot pay 24,000 crores if it is ordered. And civil defamation, it sends you the chilling effect in your spines if you are standing for freedom of speech and expression. And it is done by a corporation. So we are earlier threatened by defamation suits filed by ordinary citizens, businessmen, sometimes politicians. But today, politicians also face criminal defamation for their statements. Politicians impose criminal cases or slap criminal cases. Jayalalitha was famous, you know, for slapping hundreds and thousands of criminal defamation cases against newspapers, opposition leaders, political party leaders. Every district, there is a defamation case for one news item published in a newspaper coming from Madras and distributed in all districts. Every district, there is a criminal case. Every district for one news item. Now, this is the regulation. Now, you have all these things. And sedition cases for criticizing. And a person who is going to cover the incident of mass gang rape in Uttar Pradesh, he is being prosecuted for being a member of member of a group which is called Group of Organized Crimes. And he is facing the prosecution. Bail is denied. So the press, somewhere press is working under serious pressure, and somewhere the media is working in favor of a political party or against the political party. So that is the kind of activities that we are seeing today. Now, recently the government issued a notification in November 2020. I'll give you the latest regulatory aspects. 2020, do you know what it says? Any content that is being hosted on OTT platforms is under the ambit of Union Information and Broadcasting Ministry. And they defined news and current affairs as part of films, How can you categorize news and current affairs into entertainment information? How can you do that? But they did it. Like, you know, food stuff is the entry in the current list, concurrent list of Indian Constitution, which is used by the government of India to pass three farm legislations. It is food stuff because they have authority to deal with food stuff under concurrent list, whereas it is in fact farm produce, and farm produce is in the state's list over which center has no power. That is the level of interpreting that we are seeing today. So this is the regulatory aspect. Now, I would like to make an example, refer to an example of Kerala Chief Minister, Kerala State, which amended Kerala Police Act by ordinance, introducing Section 118A, which says that if any report is embarrassing, offensive, defamatory, causes loss of reputation and annoyance, can be prosecuted by police. Now, Police Act is meant for regulating the affairs of the police, but not to give them extraordinary powers. Kerala government has done it. We consider it as a highly educated state, and the government is a little more reasonable and truly democratic. But they came up with this kind of ordinance, which gives enormous powers into the hands of executive to arrest everybody and anybody. But there is a huge criticism all over the country. I appreciate Kerala government for one thing. It responded to 19-1A exercise by the various people of this country and canceled that ordinance. Congratulations. Thanks. So 19-1A, let me, I don't know whether I have some more time to continue. How much of time I have, Professor Stevenson ji? Can you please tell me? I will organize my conclusion. Professor, can you hear me? Hello?
Hello, sir. Sir, you can continue, sir. Can continue for a few more minutes, sir.
How many minutes, sir? Yeah. 5 minutes?
10 minutes.
10 minutes. Yes, okay. Okay. Thank you. 10 minutes. Okay. Then I was talking about the exercise of 19-1A. I tell you, sir, the Constitution has given a wonderful right. That is 19-1A, freedom of speech and expression. Though it is available only to citizens, it has very, very important power. Today, if you have protected people from draconian law called Kerala Police Act Amendment Ordinance, do you know who protected it? It is 19-1A that protected. So we are threatened when you are using 19-1A, but there is no other way except using 19-1A. If you want to protect 19-1A, you have to use 19-1A. If you want to protect the Constitution of India, you have to use 19-1A. If you are silent, if you don't take corrective measures, if you simply suffer under the fear of prosecution under sedition, contempt of court, criminal defamation, and civil defamation for crores of hundreds of crores of rupees, you will lose your Constitution of India, you will lose your 19-1A, and you will lose your democracy, and you will lose forever rule of law system and constitutional governance system. So we are in a very, very critical situation where freedom of speech and expression, if claimed by media will be blamed for giving wrong information. We can't defend media because media is biased, media is irregular, media is scandalous, media is corrupt, media is circulating fake news. It is not checking social media's fake news. So many allegations. And can you support the government nowadays? Every government is self-centric. They have their own media. They will not look into the other media. They won't give advertisements to the other media. They will see how other media can be suppressed. They want to eliminate opposition. They encourage their own party. They encourage their own media. Government is like that. Now you have social media, which is operable by any citizen. Citizens journalism, netizens journalism, blog journalism, Facebook journalism, WhatsApp journalism. You can write anything that comes to your mind. At least media is regulated. You will know media has certain limitations, licenses, permissions. They had to import newsprint. They had to have a hookup to the satellite through Information and Broadcasting Ministry's regulation. So they have to abide by certain contractual obligations. They will be registered. They can be questioned by the Registrar of Newspapers for India. There is some regulation, some responsibility, some identity, fixed identity for print media, electronic media. Even I can say for internet media also. Because somewhere your server can locate you and they can tell you. But a person who is using Facebook or some other medium generating fake news for political purposes, malicious purposes, he will be behind the screen of anonymity. Technology granted anonymity is allowing him to commit any number of crimes of fake news. Anonymity became anonymous with immunity. So anonymity, immunity, emboldens a person who is creating fake news. Now, you know, a political party will adopt a very different technological strategy to win the election. They'll pay hundreds of crores of rupees to that genius. And they really win the election. What they do? What do they do? I came to know that a political party has 9 lakh WhatsApp groups at each polling booth level. 9 lakh WhatsApp groups all over the country. And each group is specialized in circulating the news. And when they have capacity to, technical capacity to circulate news, they can circulate fake news also. I do not know whether they are circulating only fake news. Very difficult to catch, prove, establish, and get them to behind bars. Entire Indian Penal Code will be applicable to social media. Entire Criminal Procedure Code is applicable as a limitation to social media. All these enactments like Cable TV Regulation Act, which has a wonderful code under which you can block the entire internet service. You can order removal of the internet sites. You have wonderful power. If anybody says that there is no law to regulate media, please don't believe it. There is a law to regulate media. Jammu and Kashmir, media is being regulated. UP television channels are banned. Somewhere else, the websites are banned. There is regulation. There is penal law. Don't remember only Press Council of India, which is a paper tiger, which cannot do anything, which cannot stop fake news, which cannot stop unethical activities of media, which cannot stop. Now, there was one report by Press Council of India on paid news. And do you know what Press Council of India has done after taking that report? It decided not to publish that report. That is the contribution of Press Council of India. Somebody filed an RTA application. There was a huge criticism because the Press Council consists of representatives of managements who are in majority, along with take other political party representatives also. So they stand in majority. They have majority where compared to the journalists, working journalists who were fighting against paid news. They're a very small minority. So majority ruled that we will not publish it. And because of RTI Act, criticism, media attack, exercise of 19(1)(a), they gave the report. They presented the report. Now, for report, you have to fight so much. Who will ask for its implementation? So that is the level and regulatory power of the Press Council of India. And there are certain private regulatory organizations. Now, among all private regulatory organizations, only one Advertisement Standards Council of India is working very effectively. Of course, it cannot stop fake advertisements. It cannot stop all misleading advertisements also. There is a need for a very strong law for preventing misleading advertisements. But yet, within the limits, effectively working private media regulation regulatory is Advertisement Standards Council of India organization. There is a demand for giving statutory recognition to it also, but we don't know what will happen to it. So that is the situation. The another problem of impossibility of regulation of media is it is its international reach, its global approach, its speed to reach millions of people, its extraterritorial reach. Every law is territorial. International law is not a law. International law is an international agreement. And there is no international agreement on media regulation. Because most of the democratic countries believe that any regulation of media will be definitely misused by the member states, and it will result in curtailing freedom of speech and expression. So they don't. Good in a way. And because of this, there is no possibility of internet being regulated. There is no possibility of social media regulation because it is totally dependent upon internet. That is the impossibility of the regulation. And taking the example of impossibility of regulation, the media is behaving as if it is immune from every kind of criminal activity like circulating fake news. This is the problem. The only answer to this question is vibrant and active role of the media, vibrant and active role of academic organizations like Usmania University Department of Journalism, vibrant activity of voluntary journalists, netizens, civil society, media check agencies. What is it called? There is one
Media Watch.
Like Media Watch, you must have Social Media Watch. You have a fair kind of FAIR, fair kind of organizations. And there is, should be a movement. Every student, not only journalism student, every student of a university, every academic institution should think of fighting fake news. If not, it will kill their institution like JNU has been being killed by the mafia. So unless you have this kind of firm commitment and you encourage every media portal, for example, the organizations like Print, Wire.in, and Live Law and Warren Bench, where I regularly write. So all these organizations and several other web portal news agencies, which are fighting for standard journalism and which is exposing the biased functioning of media organizations and wrongdoers among the executive and legislature and judiciary, they should have a parallel wing to expose the fake news. You cannot protect this society unless you protect this society from the flood of fake news. You cannot. Impossible. And don't expect law to regulate you. If you expect law, courts, police, jails to control media, you are not an independent journalist. You are not an independent human being. Law has its own limitations. It cannot make you to do good things. It can only punish you when you have done a bad thing. It cannot help you to do good things. Law has its own limitations. Don't depend on it. Don't ask for regulation of media. I am not asking. It doesn't mean that media should be allowed to be unleashed like this. No, I'm not saying that. If there is circulation of damaging information which divides the society, you have enough regulations available in Indian Penal Code. Any communication, section 154 of Indian Penal Code. Any communication that divides the society is criminal communication and he can be punished. What more law you want? What more law? Criminal defamation is there. Contempt of court is there, which is being misused. How many regulations you want? Cable TV Regulation Act is there. Information Technology Act is there. Why do you want more regulations? don't ask for regulation. Internet shall be free. Internet shall be free. And you know, you have to question these WhatsApp-like organizations also. I don't know whether you are passing through the controversy about WhatsApp regulation. It's a new introduction of the privacy policy. And it is now revealed by the media that WhatsApp is sharing all basic information about the users of WhatsApp with the Facebook since 2016. And today there is no option available in WhatsApp to opt out of sharing of private information with others. It assumes that we have consented it and they are sharing the private information of everybody. Professor Sridhar is using WhatsApp, Facebook knows what are my choices, what are my contacts, what are my communications, what are my political thoughts, what is my purchase preference, what are my interests in watching on internet. They know completely. And we don't know that. Oh, great professors, great journalists. I don't know until I read the article recently. I was surprised to see the first page advertisement about WhatsApp. Then what must have made WhatsApp to give that advertisement? I went into probe and I found out that they are sharing the information with Facebook. They're selling, not sharing. 220 million euros. I'm not sure. More than this, perhaps more than this. They're using it. There is no data protection law in our country. And Justice S.M. Krishna, you know, S.M. Sri Krishna, he was committee head of Andhra Pradesh affairs during the Telangana movement, who gave a dark chapter. Do you know what that man has introduced in his proposal? Right to be forgotten. Do you know what is the meaning of right to be forgotten? So every person has a right to be forgotten. If he is convicted in some scandal in around 2 years ago, you are not supposed to remind it to the people. God, what a wonderful new right generated by such a great justice, which is available in Europe somewhere. And he has brought it. And luckily, it is not part of the draft legislation bill. So there is a huge conspiracy in every section of the people around to kill the truth, to kill critical thought, to kill communication of constructive information, to kill criticism of the rulers. And they are being branded as anti-nationals, unpatriotic. They are prosecuted for sedition. A school is being prosecuted for sedition, for enacting a drama against CAA. So this is the situation we are living in. Unless we protect our freedom of speech and expression, we cannot protect our constitution. We cannot protect our institution. We cannot protect our individuality. You will be in danger if you don't use 19.1A, if you don't raise your voice, if you don't speak out, if you maintain silence, you are finished. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you, Professor Madhubhushi. If there are any questions, perhaps. Sridhar will take a few questions, I guess.
Yeah, no problem.
So, will you please moderate these questions?
Can, raise their hands so that we can, you know, get you into the discussion. Anyway, true to what I described, Professor Madhubhushi Sridhar Acharyulu, I think he has brought out his three facets of a journalist, a lawyer, an academician, and I think engaged us for nearly an hour. And from whatever participation I saw, I think the numbers did not even drop by a few, which is very, very interesting. And I think these examples from real life to what we are confronting today, I think is brought out with explanations. And I think the fear and challenge that the media today really faces, I think is very, very real. We have to wake up. I think the alerts or warnings or beware signs have been long past in history. And we need to really do what we have to urgently. I think to set the tone, perhaps Professor Sridhar could tell us something about, you know, the paid news and media ethics. You know, is it a forgotten chapter, media ethics, or do you think there are some people, there is some hope?
మనకి ఒక సామెత ఉందండి తెలుగులో, ఒక గీతని మలపకుండా చిన్నగా చేయాలంటే పక్కన పెద్ద గీత ఒకటి గీయాలి. అట్లా ఈ పెయిడ్ న్యూస్ అనే ఒక ఒక ఫినామినాని డామినేట్ చేసే, దేర్ ఇస్ అనదర్ ఫినామినా దట్ ఈస్ టోటల్లీ డిజాస్ట్రస్ ఈజ్ హ్యాపెనింగ్, సో వి హావ్ గివెన్ సెకండ్ రేట్ కన్సిడరేషన్ ఫర్ ది పెయిడ్ న్యూస్. ఫేక్ న్యూస్ ఈజ్ డామినేటింగ్, bias news is dominating, so it is affecting the paid news. But as far as law of paid news is concerned, the legal thing, there is one wonderful Supreme Court judgment in 2015 or 16 given by Nageshwar Rao, our Nageshwar Rao, judge Nageshwar Rao, and another judge. He disqualified an MP, and a legislator in Uttar Pradesh was disqualified for giving the wrong accounts of expenditure, suppressing the money spent for pay news. That was what I gave in my representation to Press Council Committee. I said the election law has capacity to, the power, enough power to deal with pay news. Of course, during the election news, election only. During the non-election period, the paid news, there is no regulation. It's only an ethical point. So that is the situation. Not in paid news, even among the group of unethical things of paid news is the lesser evil now. There is a contract, you know, with the reporter or with a political contestant. There is a contract by the management, not with the reporter, by the management of the newspaper. By the management of the news organization. Today, it is no more an ethical ground for a reporter. It is organized activity of the organization. So it has grown in its size, scope, content, and it is baffling. It is very, very threatening the existence of the credibility of news organization. But nobody is thinking of controlling it. Nobody has any plan, agenda, action, program, including Press Council of India, nothing.
So I think anybody else, you can also put it on your chat box so that we can, you know, take it to Dr. Sridhar.
No, somebody asked me, Harsha Bhargavi.
Yeah.
She asked me, it's interesting, okay, fine. Is there any chance to streamline the YouTube channels by recognizing them? I'd like to tell you, there is one broad regulation that is available on entire social media. One is delisting, deleting. There are global deletion orders. And do you know which law is being used for deletion? Copyright violation. More than anything else, copyright violation is being used for deletion of the... Somebody comes up and says it is plagiarized. He is copying my report. Please remove it. And YouTube removes it. Unverified, unconfirmed, without probe, without hearing the producer of the news content maker, the program is deleted. It's again against freedom of speech and expression. Suppose you have made a video, somebody objected it to be copyrighted, and you removed it without even discussing whether it is really a copyrighted thing or not. That's one example I am giving. And there are thousands of blockades of websites, thousands of orders of blocking internet services, 3G, 4G. And there are thousands of deletions of YouTube programs from the platform of YouTube. Do you want any more controls on YouTube? This is the control of the YouTube that the powerful sections are using. That's why I'm not asking for regulation of YouTube. If there is any fake, you must immediately strive for its deletion. Deletion is important. How many people you want to go on punishing? It's very difficult. Impossible, rather. Internet content, who will regulate? Somebody raise the hand. Please ask. somebody raised hand, Sunil or something.
Sunil.
Sunil, if
Babaswami, can you unmute Sunil, please?
He went out. Perhaps he was raising hand for the last 1 minute, but I was answering Harsha Bhargavi.
Maybe Sunil, you can post your
question. Yeah, please write. Please write your question. Somebody said media is going along with societal drift, isn't it? Yeah, perhaps yes. It is an interconnected world. Societies across the world generally think and act alike because information sources or sources are universal. When somebody is deliberately introducing a fake content with a purpose, giving a color that it is genuine, true, when videos are morphed, when photographs are morphed, and people are made to believe it's an original video, what is the use of this interconnection in the world? What is the use? And it will have adverse impact on the social life. Yeah, when you say we are an integral part of the same matrix, I agree with you. Yes, yeah, you're right. But when it is harming the society, Krishna Prasad, please ask. When it is harming the society, what to do? Krishna Prasad.
Good evening. Sir, good.
Yes. Yeah, I think you wrote, Krishna Prasad. Actually, I'm having a doubt. What are the main things which is leading to produce fake news? Fake news, every vested interest generates fake news. And nobody knows who is generating this. He's hiding behind the anonymity that is available in cyber place.
Sir, I have one poor example, poor experience on this, sir, fake news. While we are in the corona lockdown, the people are spreading the news like government of India or something, which one party is giving subsidy for the train travelers. I was shocked when I received the message from my father. I was shocked. Ante how the people will mislead the innocents.
Correct.
100 and, members low, one yeah. member, 10 members ala shift aina gaani, they face a critical position while in the railway station, sir. There is no more any chances, kada.
Do you know the deaths of migrant laborers? Some yes, of sir. The deaths of migrant labor were because of fake news, wrong news, deliberately wrong news being spread. That is the reason. Wrong news and fake news are disastrous. They'll have disastrous consequences. Yes, somebody raised hand. Krishna Prasad, I think your question is over.
Done.
Anybody Thanks. Else? What is the hope if facts are interpreted in different ways, toned down by courts to avoid confrontation with the government? What is the harm of that? What is the harm that you see? If he tones down, fine, no problem. But you go by what they have written in the judgment. Their statements in the court are creating sensational debates in the media and social media. But their judgments are not seen and discussed. That is our problem. It was reported Facebook supports the right-wing Facebook groups in spreading propaganda. Ankhi Das, BJP links have come out in the open. What are you assuming that? Anything can happen. Nah? Once you give entire data in the hands of a multinational corporate capital agency, anything can happen. You have seen the impact of Canada Analytica. Have you not heard of it? Things will happen like that. And do you think that all the elections that happened recently are genuine elections? They are WhatsApp elections. They are fake news motivated, more fake news influenced elections. One of the most important principles of campaign in elections is you should not campaign for 48 hours and leave him in peace. Leave the voter in peace and let him judge. And we are campaigning through social media, even during the polling. Impossible to stop. So I at least request the people not to believe what is being circulated after the campaign period is over. Don't believe anything. And don't circulate anything. The election commission must come up with some kind of regulation not to allow any social media postures by the political parties. But how can we stop the non-political groups generating their own content and supporting some political party? How can we stop? This is the problem. The internet communication basically is impossible to be regulated. You can censor print media. You can also try to censor electronic media in televisions and radios, but you cannot stop and censor internet. Technically, it is not possible. Hema Bindu.
Good evening, sir.
Good evening.
Sir, actually, I have a doubt. Everyone feel that journalism anna, journalist anna, they are the me and oka media between the government and people anedi manak telusu. So alantappudu mari oka journalist secretariat laki allow avvalanna sare aa chance lekunda jio pass chesaru. So is that true or not? Ante adi cheyadam correcta?
Correct kaadu cheppidam andulo, definitely not correct.
Then why we are ante manam enduku raise cheyalekapothunnam? Why
adhi kada, that is my question rather. So you must go and file a writ petition at least in the High Court, whether we win or lose. You must file. We used to sit in the secretariat every day. I remember my journalism days in Hyderabad. There is a room for the press in secretariat.
Yes, sir. Even the senior journalists, sorry, sir, journalists are not allowed. And I was shocked. Why actually? So, ledu jio pass chesaru kada ani ante యాక్చువల్లీ ఉన్నది అంటే జర్నలిస్ట్ అనేవాడు అంటే లోపల ఏం జరుగుతుందో ప్రజలకి చెప్పకూడదు అనే ఉద్దేశం కొద్ది పెట్టారా, లేకపోతే రాంగ్ మెసేజ్ ని బయటికి పంపిస్తారు అనే ఉద్దేశంతో పెట్టారా అనేది అర్థం కాలేదు.
భయం, భయం. దట్ షోస్ ది ఇంపార్టెన్స్ ఆఫ్ మీడియా ఇన్ వన్ వే. ఓకే, దేర్ ఇస్ వన్ క్వశ్చన్ ఫ్రమ్ జహారా సయ్యదా. If you could please take my question. There is a young student of mine who feels that media houses are so biased. As a result, she wants to start her own web portal. I wonder to what extent a web portal can survive given defamation cases on web portals you have just discussed. See, there are threats, there are dangers, there are risks. Does it mean that you should stop working? There are road accidents, highway road accidents. Will you stop going traveling using the vehicle? So I don't think you should fear that. Don't write without basis, and don't leave issues without criticizing. When you blame an individual, think twice before blaming an individual. But before criticizing a policy, what is it you are worried about? Why should you worry? Criticize a policy, that's all. Now you raised a question, why the media is not allowed into a secretariat? Talk about it like that. Don't blame a person for that. Defamation is by individuals. So if you don't defame an individual but criticize a policy, there is no scope for defamation. This is the principle. Discuss issues, debate institutions, leave out individuals. It will definitely affect individuals, definitely. But you need not worry, na? You are not talking about anybody. So ask your friend, your student to start web portal immediately.
Any wrap up thoughts, Som?
No, I think we have gone quite a lot, and I think Sridhar garu has answered multilingually, as I said in the beginning, and I think it's given us a lot of confidence in a way that risks are quite normal. Sometimes they are high, sometimes they are low. I think we are facing a very high risk level, but that should not deter us from making our own efforts. And I'm sure, I think there are several bright young students from different fields, and journalism education should push these people into taking up the challenges. And I think there are a lot of veteran journalists who have done 3 to 4 decades, journalism teachers. I think all of them will do their bit. And I'm sure I'm a very positive, confident chap. So I think we should take these experiences and lessons that Professor Sridhar Acharyulu has, you know, explained to us very lucidly, elaborately. And also, I think since we have recorded it, I think it should be played to our students to learn as in a continuous basis. It's a very engaging and enlightening talk, Dr. Sridhar. I'm very delighted. I've been an associate and know you for more than 3.5 decades. And the way you have traversed different subjects, areas, and media is a good lesson to many of our journalism students. And as a co-journalism graduate from Usmania, I'm really thrilled that not only you bagged a gold medal, but I think you are keeping our flag shining all over. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much.
Let me take this opportunity to thank Professor Madhubhushi Sridhar for sparing his time. I think he has spent almost 2 hours now. In fact, last time when we planned this lecture, sometime in November, we were told that he was down with COVID, and we were all praying that he recover from this virus which hit him, I suppose. But I am glad that I am able to hear him. And I'm sure the audience has really enjoyed his incisive lecture. I think he has actually alerted us to the possible dangers and also reminded academic institutions as to what role they can play, and also what citizens ought to be doing in this grim situation. Thank you very much, Professor Madhubhushi Sridhar Garu. I would like to place on record my thanks to the Bashiruddin Memorial Trust. Okay, I think they have been persistent. They wanted to have this sometime in August, but then it got postponed. And thanks to Vijay, Matthew Joseph, Ranga Reddy, Krishna Rao, and the entire team behind this lecture. I would like to thank Som, who is always there for us, for moderating this session, for his introduction, and also for his concluding remarks. I am also indebted to the Advertising Club of Hyderabad, members of the Advertising Club of Hyderabad, members of the PRSI and the PRCI for their participation. I also understand there are some students from NALSAR, and there are faculty members from the University of Hyderabad. Thanks a lot for sparing your time. I know I had my own apprehensions of having this session on 15th of January, that is immediately after Sankranti. And I am told that today also is a holiday, and I think I am proved wrong, because I see quite a good participation in this event. I thank all the members of this distinguished audience who have turned up for this event, and also overseas friends who have logged in, research scholars, media professionals, senior journalists who have taken some time off their schedules. I also thank students of the department and also affiliated colleges to have attended this session, and I'm sure this is something which lift their spirit when they listen to a very senior academician, a lawyer, and also an RTA activist. Okay. I thank our own small technical team which made it possible. I'm sorry if there were some glitches, technical glitches in the early stages, but I think we somehow got over them, and we were able to listen to a wonderful lecture by Professor Sridhar Acharya Garu. Thank you, one and all. We hope not to forget this, okay? Not to forget what he has said in his lecture, right? Once again, with these few words, I would like to end here. Thanks, one and all.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Thanks.